Okay, and we're live.
All right.
Well, welcome to the TOT Doctor's Roundtable, hosted by myself and with guests for the moment, Scott Howell and Keith Nichols. How are you guys?
Well, thank you,
Today,
Stephen.
the Roundtable,
Great to
hosted
be
by
here.
myself and with guests.
Thank
Oh,
you.
well, put the sound down. Okay. So, okay, guys. Let's just introduce ourselves to the viewers if they wouldn't know us already. For the moment, you have the chat room, okay, already people in there on YouTube. So if you have any questions, type them in the chat box and we'll get back to them in a moment. So first, maybe Scott, maybe you're the least known of us three, I don't know. So tell us about yourself. How did you get into the optimization?
Well, my background is in exercise physiology. I received my first PhD in exercise physiology. And then my focus shifted to epidemiology in the second PhD program. I studied medicine at BMU through a collaboration with Wake Forest University, but I found I didn't really care about treating patients. And that was one of my real mistakes that I made, and an expensive mistake. And my real passion was conducting research. So I opted out of the fellowships and began working on two clinical trials at Wake Forest. One was the START study, strength training for arthritis trial, and the TRAILS study. It was a running study, a longitudinal running study. So my journey into hormone optimization started with androgen use in athletics and bodybuilding, by observing severe consequences, health consequences among several athletes. My major concern in all this and being a part of this roundtable is the adverse effects of androgens and how these can be mitigated in different populations.
Okay, so and you, Keith, we already know about your background a bit from the other roundtables you did, but I'm curious, when did you make the change from being out of the optimization world? Where you started because you had the need yourself, I am right?
That's right. That's right. I'm trained as a physiatrist, physical medicine rehabilitation. So I'm board certified in that, and I did sports medicine and specialized in spinal disorders for the last over 20 years. But over the last decade, I've been in the optimization field, bioidentical hormone replacement therapy, trained by Dr. Neil Ruzier. He's a close friend, brilliant man, probably the most brilliant man in the country. He's probably forgotten more about hormones than most of us know right now. So I'm going to have to give a kudos to Dr. Ruzier. If not for him, I wouldn't be here. He certainly saved my life. But I think most guys know my story. Yep, I went through it about 10 years ago. This slow decline, as you look back at it, and thought I had cancer. I tell guys there was several distinct times I would sit down to work out and just would get up and just sit on the couch, couldn't do it. Just didn't have the energy. It was extreme fatigue. Amongst many other things, I won't bore you with the details, but nonetheless, I went through the typical mistreatment that we all go through. Something's good, something's bad. I've done pellets, done creams, done gels, done injections, all various different ways, various combinations of each. And everyone knows now that I settle in, and all my patients get the choice of injections or scrotal application of cream. Before the scrotal application of cream, I do think that daily injections were a better approach. But once we developed that scrotal application with the 8 times more absorption, I do think that kind of took over for those that can do it, for those that have the lifestyle that can do it, that have the the 10 seconds plus a day to do that. But some guys, it doesn't fit into their lifestyle, and that's absolutely fine. Injections work well too. But nonetheless, we're here to optimize men, and through my personal experience, and once again, good and bad, I hope I can bring something to the table.
You certainly can, Keith. Maybe to be complete, I'll share my story short as well. As you might know, I'm a dermatologist. The most dermatologists don't have a lot of things to do with hormones, really. except for prescribing cortisone cream night and day. But me myself, I was weightlifting since I was 16 years old. So that's already 28 years going on now. And in 2017, two years and a half ago, same thing like you, Keith, I had much less energy than normal, low libido, brain fog, everything. I felt something was wrong the day that I couldn't keep up on the bike with my 7-year-old daughter at that moment. So I said to my wife, well, something must be wrong hormonally. I never had checked my testosterone levels, really. My thyroid was already optimized. So I tested the total testosterone, and it was very low, as you would expect, 250-something. Then I went to a friend, a urologist, and he said, well, normally that's a problem of old men, so you just use this androgel, which I did, and that brought up my levels till 700, but that didn't change my symptoms at all, so I wasn't really helped with that. So after 6 months, I told him, well, I don't feel better. And he said, well, the numbers are really okay, so don't worry. I said, I don't feel better. So he said, well, if you want injections, you have to go to a transgender clinic. So that was it for me. Go to a transgender clinic to have injections. Since I don't want to change sex yet, I didn't do that. So I went online, did my research, got in touch with all of you guys, and did my own research. And luckily, I'm a doctor myself, so I can prescribe myself whatever I need. And that's why I started this YouTube channel, more and more about hormones as well, next to the Hormone Optimization Group on Facebook, because I'm so thankful I got the help online. I want to share the knowledge and experience together with you guys, out to all the men in the world that need the same help like I did. So that's my story short.
Now, you were a long-term injector as well, correct?
Long-time injector?
Yeah, you were injected previously, correct?
Yeah, no, only very shortly, Keith, only very shortly. I did the androgel, then I switched to Sustanon. That's the only thing we have in Belgium here, these long esters. And first I did intramuscularly, which was really, really painful. I had two or three, and I couldn't sit in my bump for a week after one injection. So then I switched to subcutaneously. And then I got these subcutaneous nodules that stayed for weeks after injection.
I've experienced that.
Yeah. So others have told me a Sustanon is not for subcutaneous injection. I don't know. It's not for me anyways. So that's when I reached out to you, Keith, and you got me on the scrotal application, and that works really fine. So
I think it's funny. I still deal with that misconception on a daily basis. The guys come in because they want to do it, but I see a lot of failed patients now. I see a lot of guys that have seen 2, 3, 4 other clinics. That's most of my new guys now are guys that are going to be a little more complicated, but we try to simplify things for them and help them out. But it is a big misconception for the injectors. And once again, I was an injector, that you can't get the same results with the transdermal approach. And that thought process comes from the fact that when we used to apply it to the chest and upper arms, or inner thighs, you didn't. Injections were a better approach with regard to getting those levels up in an optimal range. But once again, once we get the scrotal application, you actually have to be very careful about those levels, because they can jump off the charts and very easily. I think you know that. You've posted your levels online. They're 1,800. You're free of 60. I mean, gosh, I'm dream levels. I've made no bones about it. I run the same level around 1,600, 1,700. I show everybody my labs in the office. I show where I also used to block estrogen, how I don't now, but my free level runs, 40 to 50 as well.
Okay, that's for the short introduction. I'll just have a look in the chat box on YouTube now. I'm going to say hello to some guys I know in there. Michael Kitty, Danny Bossa, hello. let's see all the guys from the group. Jorn, hello. I know you personally, of course. Thomas as well, thank you for joining. A lot of people, James Tejos, yes. Well, welcome. I see already a lot of questions. But before we do those questions, there was a question online. Yeah, maybe you can do that one first, Scott, because you say you prepared that already a little bit. My point was, why do I get the impression that in our Western society, being a man, in the sense of an alpha male, a strong, muscular, manly-looking, behaving alpha male, that concept is under attack. For example, I recently read in a comment under one of my videos that the advantage of low testosterone is that you become a better father for your kids. So what do you think about that, Scott?
Wow. Well, it's bizarre, but masculinity is always under attack. And it's over the past decade, it's just increased and increased. If you look at the current positions for allowing transgender women to compete as against biological females, it's very evident the terms he and she are now frowned upon. And if you make any a statement regarding biological sex in gender, then that's also frowned upon. The interesting thing here, I was approached by a major sport organization to write a consensus statement on this topic of transgender inclusion. But back to the point, you have to be very careful to acknowledge an opinion like what was posted and differentiate that from fact, because there are essentially no facts that equate lower T to better parenting. If you take it from an evolutionary perspective, it seems very far-fetched on one hand in the effects of T in men to influence their habits and outward expressions are likely critical to proper parenting, in my opinion. At face value, it's just poorly informed and biased by some type of unfounded belief. So, my point is to differentiate fact.
Okay.
From opinion.
Yeah. Keith?
I mean, I don't know. I don't know what you could say to that other than, echo what Scott has said. It's becoming the norm. I think that what happens is, you become overweight, sedentary, develop the super dad bod. They are a little more docile and sedentary, and the guys that are maintaining their health and exercising, I'm sure that they appear to be an aggressive, alpha male type guy, which there's becoming less of. All you have to do is look around yourself at any restaurant or when you're out shopping or at the mall, that as you have made videos about, Stephen, I mean, being healthy is not the norm now. So, you're considered a hulking, alpha male, crazy guy figure compared to these morbidly or, most, there's 60% of percent obesity here in Tennessee and it's got something like that, at least 60% along that line, maybe more. Of course they appear more docile. They are.
Yeah. And even physicians too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, yeah, Steve, yeah. Great video on that.
Yeah, I made a video on that. If you haven't seen it, guys, it's called Fit Shaming by Other Doctors. So the example was that whenever I go to a meeting with 30 other doctors in the restaurant, sponsored by a pharmaceutical firm, of course, then we have a short talk and then we have a four-course dinner. All these doctors are drinking alcohol and eating away four glasses of wine. I'm the only one sober when the meeting ends. And they all look at me and say, "Oh, why don't you drink?" I say, "Why would I? And how can you be so fit? You must be working out 4 hours every day. Where do you find the time to do that?" So it's really the norm to drink alcohol to be fat. I'm the only fit dermatologist in my province anyway. I have seen that already.
That's awesome. Yeah.
Okay. So the other thing, Keith and I already had planned an interview this evening, but we wanted to do this live event because we're a hot item on the an hormone optimization therapy forum on Facebook that I started. So that's why we wanted to do this live event. And I see we have 24 people watching, and thank you for that. And a lot more will watch this afterwards, they said to me. But we already had some topics planned, and we will cover them in depth next few weeks. But one topic that is already asked about several times on my Facebook group, as in this chat right now, is about optimizing thyroid hormones. And that was a question that I had for Keith as well. What is actually optimizing your thyroid? Because a lot of people have subclinical levels. Normal doctors, the GPs won't treat that, of course, because they only measure TSH. And they say, well, if that's fine, everything is okay, whatever the symptoms. But how do we really optimize thyroid? Is it like testosterone? Do we want really high normal levels? When are we happy with that?
Oh, well, let's see. Well, I'll preface this by saying that you've done some really great videos, and we've done a few together on optimizing all your hormones. But let's say that we've been utilizing desiccated thyroid for about 100 years. And 100 years ago, or more than 70 years ago, we treated the symptoms. A patient would come in with symptoms of hypothyroidism. They'd be weak, cold, tired, fatigued, gaining weight. And we would treat them with desiccated thyroid until their symptoms improved, or they developed symptoms of too much thyroid. That could include nervousness, jitteriness, palpitations. It increases everyone's heart rate. Your heart rate does go up, or increased sweating. So if that happened, the treatment would be just to simply lower the dose. Around the 1970s, I believe, they came out with the TSH test, and they discovered that T4 was converted to T3. And about that time, once they developed the lab test, we became a lab-centric society with regard to treating thyroid. And so they started treating a TSH level and a T4 level with the understanding that if the body needed it, it would convert the T4 to T3. So they just measure TSH and T4. The problem is not everyone converts so well. So what we measure is a free T3 level. That is the active form of thyroid at the cellular level. And that's what we want to optimize. Yes, thyroid will treat those people that are weak, cold, tired, fatigued. Most people do end up being in a normal range with regard to TSH and their T4. But you've got to understand the thyroid normative values are the normal values for a population of sick people. They really are. They don't exclude people with symptoms whenever they develop these normative ranges. But nonetheless, some of the societies don't believe in people not converting. But so what we do is when we're trying to optimize thyroid, women are much more sensitive to their thyroid than men. It plays a role in their ovulation. They're very, very sensitive to it, very needy of it. Men, not always so much so. You've heard me say this before, and I'll say it again. There are two feel-good hormones. When you have deficiencies or symptoms of a deficiency of these two hormones, you're going to feel it. You're going to know it. You're going to be fatigued. You're going to have some issues, and that's testosterone and thyroid. The other hormones, whether it be DHEA, pregnenolone, melatonin, vitamin D3, you could be deficient in those, and you'll never know it. As I tell my patients, you could come in and be deficient in every one of those hormones, and just give someone testosterone thyroid, they'll feel better. They could also come in deficient in all those hormones, and you could just give them DHEA, vitamin D3, pregnenolone, melatonin, other supplements, they're not gonna feel much better. They're not feel-good hormones. So we aim for target levels in those others. But when it comes to testosterone and thyroid, if a person that gets optimal on testosterone with regard to a male continues to have symptoms of fatigue, weight gain, tired, then we'll start looking at optimizing their thyroid levels. And when we do that, we are looking to raise the free T3 level into the upper end of the normative range for a young, healthy person. And, we'll start the dose in the morning. And then if they continue, we have to increase that dose, we'll increase to a certain point. And then at that time, if they continue to have a lot of afternoon fatigue, we'll then add a dose in the afternoon, about 8 hours apart. T3 has a 8-hour half-life. So we're going to give you a lot of teaching here that you guys have been wanting, different from the past. And so why do we supplement with desiccated thyroid? I'm going to go ahead and answer questions before they develop. When you give either T4 alone or T3 alone, you shut down the thyroid's production of both T4 and T3. The thyroid produces mostly T4, but it does produce some T3. It could be 15-20%, depending on where you're eating. But nonetheless, if you take just T3, which is Cytomel, which is a lot of bodybuilders will, or if you take just T4, which is levothyroxine, which is what the endocrinologists give, then you actually shut down your thyroid's production of those hormones. When you do that and you're only taking T4 and you don't convert to T3 enough, you're not a good converter, then you're going to be symptomatic. Same way with taking just Cytomel. When you take just Cytomel, it's going to shut down your thyroid's production of T4 and T3. And once that T3 runs out in 8 hours, you're not going to have any T4 to convert. So you'll hit a wall and you'll be symptomatic as well. So most people tend to find that they do better with a mixture of both T4 and T3. So that summarizes the treatment of thyroid. I can't give any numbers. I can't tell you what to do, but I can tell you that's what we do.
Okay. Here in Belgium, we only have T4 on the market. Mm-hmm. But my pharmacist could order Armor. That's a mixed T3 and T4. I don't know where it comes from internationally. Mm-hmm. So I'm on that.
I have seen some. Now you'll see some patients that come in and they get Cytomel online. I mean, evidently that's available online. And some have come in and they've actually adequately made their own mixture of T4 and T3. I mean, when you really look at it, the Armour Thyroid is 38 micrograms of T4 and 9 micrograms of T3.
Mm-hmm. Scott, you have any opinion on that?
Well, with thyroid, I mean, it's a complex topic, like he was talking about. It's all revolves around enzymes. And if you don't have the enzyme capacity to convert T4 to T3 into the active form, you run into problems. And if your body produces a reverse form of T3, you also run into problems. So I think what Keith said is right on point. One point of clarification, though, Keith, can you differentiate pharmaceutical grade thyroid medications from
the
brains that you're talking about?
You can. I'll tell you, Armour Thyroid tends to work a lot better than Natrathroid. It does, or NP Thyroid. So you can get someone in an optimum range with those. It just tends to take more. But I think the standard for which all of those are measured is Armour Thyroid.
Okay. I'll just try to read some of the questions that appeared in the chat box for the moment. A man with a very difficult name, is just all letters, whatever, Fire 12, asks, is the cream a far better option than injections? Should I start using HCG or better to start without it and add if needed? What's your opinion, Keith?
Well, you've done them both. I'll tell you this. I think that your best options to start with, the best options, no matter who you are, is either a daily sub-Q injection or twice daily transcrotal cream.
Okay. And about the HCG, you just add in later if you need it?
I find that most men, or all men that I've treated, do better not on HCG than on HCG. So there's two reasons they do it. One is to preserve fertility. I understand that. So if they need it for that, I'll prescribe it for that. Or they can always start HCG or HMG Clomid later. There's various protocols you can utilize to, regain spermatogenesis. But the other reason is to maintain testicular size to prevent testicular shrinkage. I will tell you that I've not noticed that in any of my patients. None of them complain of it. I did read a study that made me chuckle a couple of weeks ago. I need to refine it and I need to post it. But it did a little study on that, on men that complained of that. And what they did is they studied these men that were on it, and they found that the men that tend to notice testicular shrinkage, and this study actually said this, were men that had small testicles to begin with. They tended to notice it. The other guys didn't really notice it to any significant degree. So I will just, people can be on it if they want. It's an option. I find that they do better off of it than on it. I will tell you this, with regard to HCG treatment, I can double anyone's testosterone levels with HCG by itself, but I can't make you feel any better. Do you understand? Mm-hmm. Read between the lines there?
Yeah.
I can double a number, but I can't make you feel any better.
Yeah. You agree, Scott?
Oh, yeah. I've used HCG in the past, and from all the literature that I've read on HCG, it's very effective for fertility, and testosterone in itself is almost like a male birth control. It has contraceptive properties. So unless there's a specific reason for it, beyond for, well, just for fertility, I think it's sort of frivolous to use. But mm-hmm. you gotta think there's some people out there that are borrowing from bro science and carrying HCG over from the bodybuilding community. And the point is that type of, if you have an induced type of hypogonadism that's caused by long-term use of androgens in an abusive manner, it's distinctly different. And HCG has its own feedback loop, negative feedback loop, that will still come into play even after you come back off of it. So, you know, I sort of went off the reservation on the topic, but.
No, that's good. That's good. I'm glad you did. Yeah. But, and there's one question in there too. Can somebody use a scrotal with post-vasectomy pain? The answer is yes. Yes. Mm-hmm. Make sure we cover that.
Okay. And I had a question on the same topic for a friend of mine, really, that wrote me this question a few weeks ago. He's 40 years old, and they're trying to have a baby for the moment. It seems not to go fine after 1 year or something. And he had his levels checked, and he had the total testosterone of 200. So he asked me, should I go on TRT? But his GP advised against it because he said, then you will be infertile for sure, of course. So what should he do? Should he go on TRT with HCG, or would he just try to have a kid like that and start TRT afterwards?
Go ahead, Scott. You want to borrow a bit?
Well, in my opinion, he could take both. He could take HCG if needed for that fertility reason, and the testosterone replacement, and it would likely not influence in a negative manner. But as far as specific clinical experience, I don't have that, and I think Keith might be able to fill in the lines. But I think the guy should probably be on testosterone replacement.
Well, there's a lot of danger in testosterone at 200 being that low. Of course, we know all the dangers with that. So, I mean, it'd be great to be able to have kids, but if you're not going to live long enough to watch them grow up, that's not a good thing. And I don't say that lightly with a low testosterone level like that. The party line would be to tell them this: look, you can just try HCG alone, see if it works for you. You can try Clomid. You know, you can do all those things. If you don't feel any better, still having symptoms, then unfortunately, if you fail those, the only step would be testosterone. Is there a chance of infertility? Yes. But once again, if you can take it along with HCG, or you can, there are various protocols that you can start HCG, HMG, Clomid. You could always stop testosterone. You're ready to have children and start the, you know, what I just mentioned to get spermatogenesis going again. So there are various ways you can go about it. But once you open that Pandora's box, there's, like I said, there's no guarantee in medicine. But the majority of people, not all, for the most part, do regain spermatogenesis. It may take up to 6 months to a year in a lot of men, but nonetheless, most do.
You can also preserve the sperm. You can have the sperm bank.
Great point. I'm shocked at the number of mid-30-year-olds that I see come in that have already done everything that I've listed. They've been on HCG somewhere, Clomid. You know, they've gotten on testosterone, weren't doing very well, level still low. But they already had their sperm frozen when they came to see me. They knew what they wanted to do.
Oh, yeah. That's great.
Good point. Okay. So another question I saw passing here. Someone has been struggling a while with midday fatigue. And he writes, I am now off of cortisol. I have now noticed a crash after my espressos. Is it as simple as caffeine causing my fatigue?
Well, that's very complicated because you have to know the amount of caffeine consumption that if it's a regular habit, if he's a caffeine user multiple times a day, the receptors in your brain will start to attenuate from caffeine very quickly. So the crash he might be experiencing might be an effect of increased exposure to caffeine over a long-term period. The good thing about caffeine is that that whole, I guess, situation that I described can be pretty much stopped by going off caffeine for about 7 days. But there are symptoms of withdrawal sometimes if someone has used caffeine over and over. Like, you know, I've heard of people drinking 6 to 8 cups of coffee a day or more for prolonged periods, especially when they're dieting, because, you know, when you start to restrict calories, no matter what you do, you're going to feel fatigued easier. But as far as the crash, there's no way to assign a causal effect here, because there's too many, we have to know more information.
Scott, that was an excellent answer. And I'll tell you, I have some, Jim, I'll answer that for you too, is that I had a bad habit last year of every day at lunch, I would just need to get out of the office to get some fresh air, but I'd immediately go to Starbucks and get a cup of coffee. And about an hour later, I'd crash, literally crash. Yeah. But then I decided, well, you know, I just need to stop that habit of going out to lunch, and, you know, I needed to stay in and do other things. And when I stopped that, it's amazing what Scott just said. I didn't hit that. I did not crash like I did when I would actually go have coffee, which I thought would wake me up. But it didn't. It had a paradoxical effect. So there's a lot to be said for what Scott just pointed out. So I would certainly give that a try. Of course, some of us that have low T3 or, you know, suboptimal thyroid, we may need to look at that as well. But we certainly need to look at lifestyle factors. And what Scott just pointed out with caffeine was brilliant.
Well, habits, even in nutrition, which you had written some points about nutrition and stuff like that. If the lifestyle habits are not addressed, then the whole process of optimization is compounded or confounded. And if you're not willing to make that sacrifice in healthy habits, then there, in my opinion, there's no point of optimizing hormones, because it seems to me to defeat the purpose. And without the proper nutrition, the proper training, the proper rest, and the proper hormone optimization, it's fruitless.
Yeah, hormone optimization is just the icing on the cake. All the rest you should do yourself, really.
Agree 100%.
Yeah, so I recently made a video about common TRT mistakes, and that was one of the things I said, not put enough attention to your sleep, to your diet, to your workout, etc. One of the questions I get repeatedly, and it's again in the chat box by Michael Kitty, is do we need to add DHEA and pregnenolone, because he wrote progesterone, pregnenolone, as we start the tea cream, or can we wait a few months and see how we feel and add if needed? I already know that Keith wants to optimize everything at once. And I said in my video recently, change one parameter at a time, so you know what you're feeling, what you're doing. So what's your take again on that, Keith? How do you know how people feel if you change a lot at one time?
Well, I was prepared for this at the beginning. That's why I answered it at the very beginning, set the stage, is that there's only two feel-good hormones, baby. You can take all the DHA in the world, you're not going to feel any better. It's not going to do it. It doesn't work that way. So it's the testosterone and thyroid that really will get to you, especially in men, that testosterone. So DHEA, pregnenolone, vitamin D3, they're not really feel good hormones. All right. So with that said, you got to optimize that testosterone no matter what. Optimize thyroid in certain individuals, but DHEA stimulates the immune system, decreases visceral body fat, which is responsible for at least 13 different cancers. It's good for your bones, ligaments, tendons, joints. It is used to treat lupus. It's an anti-inflammatory. It improves sexual dysfunction, improves your lipid profile. Let me think. Do I want to optimize that, or do I want to get the minimal results and just keep it low? Look, these guys that are taking testosterone have normal levels of testosterone, pretty much everybody in this chat room. But yet they're still supplementing with testosterone to optimize those levels, because they know the beneficial effects of testosterone. Why would you not DHEA? Why? I don't understand. Each individual hormone has its own individual beneficial properties, and you want to optimize all those hormones. That's part of a preventative medicine program, not just a testosterone replacement program. Most men are so caught up in just testosterone. They forget about all the beneficial effects of hormone. That's where Dr. Ruzier is so brilliant. I mean, we see literature, just mountains of literature on every individual hormone, and understand the benefits of optimizing each individual one. And once you see that, I don't understand why anyone wouldn't want to have all those on board in an optimal range to prevent the diseases of aging that they can prevent.
Yeah, okay, I agree. Scott, anything to add?
Well, it's interesting because, you know, in the notes that I prepared, completely separate from Keith, I wrote, in my opinion, tea comes in number one as long as aromatase is not impeded with the use of AIs, because this solves the problems for most symptomatic males, and it really does. So as far as the other stuff with experience, I'm changing my current therapy right now under guidance of a physician to include the transscrotal approach and to start with the thyroid optimization. So as soon as that comes up, I'll let you guys know what the results are.
Okay. Another question, Dr. Nichols, do you prescribe metformin in your protocol?
I do. I try to do it as a courtesy to the patients that come in that have studied it as far as an anti-aging drug goes. I mean, once again, anything that improves your insulin sensitivity, you're gonna benefit from. So we want to decrease insulin resistance. So I use metformin. Okay. I use metformin myself. My wife uses metformin. You know, it's a big part of treatment of PCOS. We have a lot of women with PCOS, and it's a big part. PCOS is insulin resistance. So metformin is a big part of the practice. A lot of studies going on right now, some big ones, you know, the TAME study, for instance. And so it's got some nice properties outside of its original use for, you know, type 2 diabetes.
And what dose do you prescribe?
I use only the extended release form, and the immediate release form will tear your stomach up. So I use the extended release form, and I try to work up to as much as a person can tolerate, which would ultimately be a gram in the morning, a gram in the evening. So it'd be 500 milligram tablets in the morning and two in the evening. Typically, you'd want to work up one tablet a week at a time until you work up. Take you 4 weeks to work up with that four tablets.
Okay. You too, Scott?
I don't take metformin at the moment. I'm going to start taking it soon. But if I remember correctly from the literature I've read, metformin has a direct effect on telomere length and DNA. So it is a substance that has value in anti-aging, although I hate to sort of use that term, but it does at the DNA level, it has a value. From all I've seen, it's favorable. So,
mm-hmm. Okay. And someone asked, any particular clinical concern when you're dealing with men over 60? I would add to that, do you start optimizing hormones differently for men of 30 years old, 40, 50, 60 or older?
No, they're just much easier to treat. When you start getting into your 50s and 60s and you are typically, by the time you seek treatment, you have you're very symptomatic. You've hit rock bottom, and those guys, such as myself, when I started in the 40s, anything to feel better is awesome. And so these guys are, we weren't born in an era of social media. We're not on forums. We just go to the doctor and, yes, sir, whatever you say. I just feel terrible, and they'll do what you say. They don't go read forums. They don't second guess you by getting information from other men and bro science. They're just the absolute easiest, pleasant guys to treat. I mean, I'll take a billion 60-year-old men and 50-year-old men for sure.
Okay. Do you think, guys, that the endocrine society will start to gain a greater understanding of male hypogonadism through your expert training patients successfully and restoring their health? I don't know. Will the endocrine society learn from us?
It's up to Scott. They will, and Scott's got the answer to that. So tell us how we're going to do that, Scott.
Well, you have to really consider what the endocrine society really is. And if you look at the members of the endocrine society, I would imagine there's at least 90% of the researchers that are conducting research and, you know, issuing or signing on to consensus statements have direct interest in pharmaceutical companies. And I'm not saying that to say that they're biased in one way or another, but if you look at the endocrine society guidelines that mandate that you have to be tested, or it's suggested to be tested more than one time in the morning, with there has to be a repeated measure of low testosterone. Basically, what this does is it claims that the rate of prescriptions is directly attributed to people seeking hormones that don't need hormones, when in fact, they are not considering the alternative argument. And the alternative argument is there's a population level decline in testosterone that can't be explained by the what they advise in the endocrine out guideline, in the guidelines by repeated measurements. It can't be explained by that. But they take no effort to address that topic of why there's a population level decline in testosterone levels. So you could easily think off the top of your head, well, it's probably diet and nutrition in most people. And that's a good argument because in all likelihood, nutrition and diet and lifestyle factors are involved with lower testosterone levels at a population level. However, it's such a substantial increase over the decades in the population level decline, in my opinion, and this was, you know, I just started into this, what, 6 months ago or less with you, Keith?
Right.
Is that there's another factor involved. And our daily exposure to EDCs through plastic, through eating utensils, through almost everything we come into contact with, even some shampoos and stuff like that, have endocrine disrupting chemicals that influence not only the like testosterone androgen levels, but also all other sex hormones, thyroid hormones. I had an OBGYN just talk to me about how common it was for her to prescribe a Synthroid to young females that were as young as 17, 18 years old. And she said it was a common occurrence. And in my mind, there's another causative factor that's influencing this. And it's exactly what Keith was talking about. It's in endocrine disrupting signals or chemicals. If you look in the literature every day, there's another piece of research that has found and identified a different endocrine disrupting chemical in a water supply. I mean, it's international now, and the EPA has identified a list of about 25, 26 EDCs that they know have adverse effects on testosterone or other sex hormones. About 9 or 10 of these have been identified to alter how the androgens are used in the body, how the hormone receptor complex is activated inside the body. And unless this alternative explanation is drawn out to conclusion, I think it's just a poor choice on a society like the endocrine society to issue these statements and deny that all this other evidence that there's other factors involved. I don't want to just keep on forever. What do you have to add, Keith?
Let's see. Yes, we are being poisoned by our environment. We are being chemically castrated by our EDCs. You know, I had something I really wanted to point out to you there with regard to the endocrine society. Now it's skipped my brain, but nonetheless, that's what Scott and I kind of want to do with our research is, this is what I wanted to say, is that the problem with what's going on with EDCs and why it's going to be so difficult is that the EDCs completely disrupt the way we diagnose and treat diseases at the present time. Right now, we're a lab-centric medical system. And whenever you start dealing with disorders, and a person can with normal labs, but they have the disorder, that creates havoc. So that's going to completely disrupt how we diagnose and treat disorders. We're already seeing it with testosterone. But nonetheless, what Scott and I would like to prove with regard to the EDCs is that you can have normal levels of a hormone, but still be fully symptomatic with regard to that individual hormone. So we're interfering with it, our ability to use the hormone. Steroid hormones like testosterone are completely receptor mediated. Anything that prevents that that testosterone from binding to its receptor will cause problems. So that's what the EDCs do. They bind to that androgen receptor and they prevent testosterone from binding to it. You can have all the testosterone outside the cell that you want or in the cell even, but if they can't bind to their receptor, it can't exert a response.
One of the issues with actually measuring EDC exposure is that the EPA, although they had this special agenda to put EDCs on top and do more work, they haven't created standardized tests where these chemicals can be tested for in practice. So I've been working with a chemist that's locally in Tennessee to see if they can develop some standardized tests that we can use in clinical trials to see if clients are coming in with EDC exposure and we can quantify that exposure. It won't say that one causes the other, but it can show that people are coming in with symptomatic and they're symptomatic, they're symptomatic and it's related to a hormone deficiency, or that their testosterone levels are in the normal range and they're still symptomatic. And it's, I suppose that makes sense, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And a personal question, are there any supplements we can take to protect ourselves from EDCs?
Wow.
Hormones. Hormones are the only thing you can do. You know,
and it's such a big problem because not only do you have to look at the immediate effects like the hormone or the ligand receptor interactions like Keith was talking about, but now there's evidence to suggest that generations that or people that were first conceived and under EDC exposure now have certain mutations that have been passed down to their offspring. It's a field that needs more direct scientific interest. And basically our argument is gonna focus on the population level declines, EDC exposure, and how the numbers cannot be explained through what the endocrine system society claims and states in their guidelines.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a new field of biology. It's a brand new field of biology. It's we're in the we're just in the vast unknown. We're just discovering some of these, and like Scott says, we don't know how to test for them. We don't even know how to test them. We're not even testing them correctly right now, Scott, as you know, and as you know, Stephen. And then we don't even know how they act. We're used to testing one chemical at a time with regard to traditional toxicology. These things act in concert with each other. You know, they may be safe by themselves, but when they act with two or three others, they may become a toxin. So that's the problem that we're running into. It's a bad environment right now.
Yeah. Somebody asks, can you recommend some good anti-stress, anti-anxiety supplements? L-theanine, perhaps pregnenolone? Guys,
L-theanine. There's some research on L-theanine for anxiety. Most of my knowledge comes from nootropics and things like piracetam, which I'm not sure if that's indicated for anxiety or not. But off the top of my head, I can't think of any major ones. Can you think of any, Keith?
I like L-theanine myself. I actually take it. I like it a lot. You can always exercise. There's sex.
Well, one thing about anxiety is if someone's experiencing anxiety, they need to exclude all factors that might be causing it. Like if they're drinking coffee, like we were talking about earlier, and let's see, coffee, any other stimulants they might be taking, these can all have effects on anxiety. So unless the habits are known and someone hasn't made a valid effort to try to identify other factors that could be involved, you know, it's sort of quick to jump the gun just to try to take something to cure it or to address the issue.
Very good point. Excellent point.
Yeah. Can TRT lower the need or dose for SSRIs? And my question actually was for you. I already had it for you, Keith. You know, how do SSRIs lower testosterone actually?
The mechanism, I'm not real sure, but they do cut it quite significantly. We do know that. We do have many men that come in on an SSRI that are able to get off their SSRI when they do start testosterone replacement therapy, or are already on testosterone therapy, but not quite optimal. And then we get them in an optimal range. They're able to discontinue their SSRI.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Michael Kitty asks, is metformin and Cialis low dose, 2.5 to 5 milligram a day, a good protocol to provide 50 plus men a strong cardioprotective effect?
You know, I can't. I don't have
two parts of the equation. I mean, you know, Cialis has, increases nitric oxide. It's been shown to improve cardiac perfusion even after heart attack. So I mean, I think that those are fine protocols. Have become very popular in the anti-aging crowd. Like I said, I don't use that word anti-aging very often. In fact, I try not to at all. But nonetheless, they certainly are being used in that arena, and there's good reason to. There's data to support their use.
Okay. A lot of questions. anyway, we'll have to keep some for the next podcast, of course. Starting from now, we'll try to do these regularly. You haven't already, subscribe to the channel and follow us on the TRT and Hormone Optimization Therapy Facebook group. You can leave all your questions there. If we can't answer them there directly, we'll keep them for next podcast. I still had another question for both the docs for now, for myself. I said, I suppose we all as doctors have slightly different takes on how to optimize hormones. What hormones do you want to see optimized, and how do you tackle that? In what order exactly? Maybe start with Scott.
Well, for me, as far as the optimization process goes, I'm really here present because I'm concerned about the evidence and claims that are made by interpreting the evidence. In my opinion, testosterone is number one. And again, I reiterate the concern that the aromatase and the E2 that results from that should not be impeded with AIs. And this will solve the problem for, I'd say, most symptomatic men that come in. As far as the order and more hormones, I'm going to pass that to Keith.
Well, in a postmenopausal woman, it's vitally important that they're never without their estrogen. Estrogen has so many protective effects in women. Women, after they become menopausal, cardiovascular disease becomes their number one killer, but only a couple of decades after they've been devoid of their estrogen. So, you know, you want to provide them with all the protection that you can. And the way you do that is you never let them be without their estrogen. So in a woman, estrogen, along with progesterone, whether they have a uterus or not. There are progesterone receptors in the brain, bones, breast, blood vessels, vagina. So, you know, whether you have a uterus or not, those women need their progesterone. Also, testosterone is important in women. They need some. They just don't need as much as men do. But it provides them with all the benefits that it does men. And once again, thyroid is important in women. As we age, thyroid, we've outlined earlier in this conversation all the positive effects of thyroid, so you want to make sure that it's optimal. And then once again, because I'm a preventative medicine program, we know all the beneficial effects of all the individual hormones. I once again will optimize their DHEA, vitamin D3, pregnenolone, and melatonin. So in a premenopausal woman, doesn't need estradiol. A lot of them can benefit significantly from the utilization of progesterone. You can't hurt anyone with progesterone. It's very good for migraines. It's very good for PMS. So, but in a premenopausal woman, you don't give them estradiol, but you can certainly, a lot of them come in with no testosterone at all. If they're on birth control, their testosterone zero. So, yeah, you optimize all the same ones except estradiol in a premenopausal woman. In a man, testosterone, of course, is first and foremost. It's your feel-good hormone. Then, of course, thyroid. And then you know that I optimize all of them. And I've outlined the reasons why. DHEA, vitamin D3, pregnenolone, melatonin, all those. Because just so I don't, it's hard enough to get men and women just to optimize their base hormones. I try to really stick to this is when you build a house, I mean, you can either build a spec home or you can build a custom home, but you know, you want to build a strong foundation in whatever you do. So, you know, to look at your body as a custom home, I mean, build that strong foundation, and it all begins with your hormones. You've got to get those hormones at an optimal level. And that is your strong base for which foundation for which everything else can be built on. They're bullets, supplements, and all those other things. They're BBs. You got to get the bullets in there. And so it's hard enough just to get people to do that. So to overcomplicate matters, I try not to, you know, get into when I'm talking to my patients a lot about different supplements, unless they ask, and about all these other things, whether it be peptides or SARMs, this, that, and the other, because it is hard enough. And I think they see it enough when I see they've already been to 2, 3, 4 other clinics. It's hard enough to get their baseline hormones optimal. And I'm a bioidentical hormone replacement physician. I'm there to optimize the hormones that are proven in the medical literature to provide them benefits. So that's what I try to do. Nothing overly fancy. Don't want to spend a lot of money on excessive labs or, you know, put my name on a supplement bottle and spend a lot of money on that. I want them to take the hormones and spend their hard-earned money on their hormones that we know from the medical literature will make them better.
Okay, thanks. We're almost at the 1 hour mark, so I'll pose one last question myself that I send you on forehand. So for the lifters among us, like I am, and I hope you are too still, being fully hormonally optimized, inclusive thyroid and testosterone, can one eat a bigger amount of calories a day and stay lean? And is it easier to build muscle when eating in a caloric surplus with less chance of accumulating fat? Okay. So what do you think, Scott?
Well,
being optimized, a good position to stay lean and eat more and build more muscle?
Yes, for the most part. Now here it gets a little complicated. I'm going to have to sort of try to truncate this.
Go ahead.
Yes, for the most part. However, Kiko, calories in, calories out, always applies to considerations of nutrition, no matter what. Anyone who eliminates Kiko from the conversation is not really thinking about the big picture. Hormones do not magically alter the second law of thermodynamics, like Ludwig and Feynman have claimed. And you know, one of the reasons why I published a piece in the American Physiological Society in 2017 was to counter that claim in the literature. And I came under a storm of hellfire for doing that. Building muscle only occurs when the total sums of catabolism and anabolism favors overall nitrogen retention. It will be easier to build muscles because of enhanced amino acid recycling inside of the muscles and thus nitrogen retention in the overall muscles. So the chances of accumulating fat, holding hormones, nutrition, and rest optimized are lower. So Kiko and energy expenditure always apply no matter what.
When we start someone on hormones and they're not used to having them, they're all deficient, you will see maybe up to a 10% change in their body composition just because they're getting something they haven't had. You know, thyroid's going to increase metabolism, increase energy expenditure. So you're going to lose some weight. I mean, people lose weight on thyroid. They're going to do the same with testosterone. It decreases visceral and subcutaneous body fat, increases lean muscle mass. But after that, if you eat and sit on the couch, you're going to gain weight, gain it all back. So Scott's absolutely right. But we certainly give you the tools to build lean muscle and decrease body fat when we replace your hormones. You certainly will have the tools to build a house, we say. Whereas a lot of people that come in that are zero and everything or close to zero, they can work out all day long and they can calorie restrict, but they're not going to see a lot of gains or improvement.
Well, in that respect, it is easier. If you're optimized and you're thinking about your lifestyle habits, your hormones are optimized, your nutrition is solid, and you're getting adequate rest, then it would be easier. Mm-hmm. As perception wise, it's going to be easier, but sure. you as long as you got all that stuff in, hey.
Yeah. Well, from personal experience, I've been tracking my calories since May 2015, and being optimized, I can say that I can eat 10% more calories and maintain the same weight. Normally, if I would calculate what I can eat to maintain, that would be 2,800 calories for me. But I can easily add 3,000 and stay on the same weight, taking weekly average weigh-ins. So it must be that it's easier to burn calories, or maybe I'm just more active. I have maybe a higher needs without realizing it.
Well, your resting metabolic rate is higher too because of it. The lean body mass that you have, and that process of recycling amino acids, it takes energy. Everything inside the body takes energy. So when you add more lean body mass to your frame, your resting metabolic rate gets higher. Your as far as your NEAT and stuff, have you went on the NIH website and looked at their body composition tracker?
No, what's that?
But it's a tracker that was developed from data from a fellow named Kevin Hall. He was the one that published the piece that falsified the insulin hypothesis in regards to carbohydrates. And basically, when people want some type of objective information to track their body composition, I always take them back to the National Institutes of Health and the body composition tracker that Dr. Kevin Hall used. His formulas are used in that. And his studies were the best quality controlled studies on, energetics and fat metabolism that are probably ever conducted. So it's, if anyone goes to the NIH, they can look. I think it's in the portion under kidney disease at the NIH, but there's a free tracker. You can plug in your information and it provides a logical plan and reasonable goals for body composition changes in regards to time. So it's a useful tool.
Can you maybe put the link in the chat box?
Let me see if I can find it real quick.
Would be nice.
Maybe the guys can give us some ideas of what they'd like us to teach on an upcoming, you know.
Yeah, good idea, Keith.
And I think, you know, maybe we can ask them if they would like to see, maybe we do a little bro science segment every so often where we just read some of the recommendations that people make online from some of the bro science forums and kind of explain why that's just not good advice.
Yeah, great idea. So let's round this podcast up in a few minutes. So guys, let's keep the questions coming on the Facebook group we're all in. And if you have more questions for the roundtable doctors, let them know. And we'll have Dr. Rob, Dr. Merrill as well. We'll try to have them on in the future episodes as well. So you can all leave your questions for them as well. And as Keith proposed, we can talk about some bro science that is going on different other forums on Facebook, on the internet, because there's a lot of bad advice given there. And so let's talk about that and explain why that is bad advice exactly.
Well, Faz, I appreciate you letting me come in. My wife loves lifting dermatologists, by the way. So I'm glad I'm not a jealous man.
Okay, thank you. So guys, before rounding up, maybe people want to know how they can reach out to you. Scott, how can people reach out to you if they want to contact you?
They can reach me at S Howell at T1HW.com. And I can reply to emails through there.
Tier one HW.
Is it tier one HW? I'll put it in.
Yeah. So Scott and I could both reach. I'm K Nichols at tier1HW.com and Scott is, you know, at tier1HW.com. We look forward to beginning our research journey after the end of this month. We'll start hitting that big time. So I look forward to working with Scott and I hope we have big things in the future together. And I hope he comes on board and we can add a lot to the practice.
And hopefully through this platform, we can maybe in the future with some of the protocols that we have just put down as potential, we can maybe gain some greater recruitment into some studies. So we're hoping through this platform to be able to focus and move the hormone optimization field forward by increasing awareness and chances for participation in real studies at the practice in Chattanooga.
That's right. Practice is just relocated to Chattanooga, Tennessee, 8 minutes from the airport, and it's Tier 1 Health and Wellness.
Great, guys. Thanks. I'm just putting all the links that Scott put in the text box again and the group as well. Okay, so if you have anything more to add, now's the moment. And if not, I'll thank you for the moment. Scott, Keith.
Thank you. And I would recommend that everyone go and watch before our next meeting. Go watch all your YouTube videos. They are excellent. They are all excellent. Love them.
Great videos.
We love them. I love them. My wife loves them. We love them. We'll watch them and, you know, we get entertained.
You're too kind. Okay, bye, guys. I stopped the recording here.
All right. Hey, thanks, man. I appreciate it.
I think that went well for you, Stephen. What do you think, Scott?
I think so, too.